My name is Lloyd McKenzie. I'm an independent consultant with Jeopardy. I've been involved with fire for, like 6 years ago. Been moved to my third time at my map. Most relevant to you, I've treated over 10 implementation guides for a variety of ones, most of them using the age of 7. And we're going to spend the next 30 minutes or so looking at implementation guide tooling. I'm going to go over two tools, the age of 7 IG publisher, and looking at Trifolia as well. And then Martin's going to come in and chat about Simple Fire. Before we get into any of the tools for IG publication, I want to also take a look at what are, in general, the inputs to the IG publishing process and what do we produce. We are not going to do a deep dive into any of the tools because that would take us 2 to 4 hours apiece, and we don't have that, but we will sort of give you a cursory overview of what the tools look like, what they can do. So for whatever tool you're using, you're going to have a number of inputs. You're going to have an implementation guide resource, which by the way is currently under examination for considerable revamp. People realize that we're actually using an implementation guide resource for two very different purposes, and we may actually want to split it into two different resources. One is defining what we want to publish, and one is exposing what we have published for downstream purposes like validation and creating implementation guides. We also have a whole set of performance resources, so structured definitions, profiles, extensions, performance capability statements, value sets, naming systems, a wide variety of things that are all relevant to those who are trying to implement your implementation guide. And then a bunch of standalone page content, whether that's written in Markdown or written in HTML, that describes everything that we're talking about this morning. How do you use security? What are my use cases? Why should you want to implement this implementation guide? That was so awesome. And you should definitely spend the next 4 weeks coding so that you can do what you want to do. And then most of the implementation guide tools also have some sort of configuration. The degree of configuration varies. Some of them are pretty straightforward in that you will get the implementation guide for this tool knows how to produce, and you might be able to vary a couple of things, but most of your output's going to look the same. Everybody who uses that tool sort of gets the same sort of feel. Others are quite flexible. They will let you customize all sorts of different things, which increases the complexity when you're trying to author, but also increases your degree of control and lets you produce a number of styles. And then coming out of that, you have your rendered implementation guide. Typically, those are static websites, so you can navigate content using HTML. On occasion, you might generate PDF documents. And you will also produce packages of contents. So you will package up your input artifacts, your capability statements, your profiles, your extension definitions, etc., in a form that's usable by downstream systems. So typically that means if you author your content in XML, spit it out in XML and JSON and maybe in RDF, package it up into a nice little zip file so that people can download a zip of your examples, download a zip of all of the JSON definitions and all of the XML definitions, download an IG pack that is necessary to pass off to a validator to say, I want to validate my instances against this implementation guide. Here is everything that the validator needs in terms of value sets, profiles, extensions, etc. to make that happen. Package as tightly as possible so the load process isn't as horrible as it might be. As part part of the implementation guide authoring process, you need to author all of the content. And there's actually a growing number of resources that we have to worry about, or at least potentially worry about, when you're looking at creating an implementation guide. So the implementation guide resource itself that says, here's all the profiles, here's what my implementation guide is for, etc. We've got a couple of tools that do that. One is Forge, one is Trifolia. By the way, these slides will be available to you, which means that all of the hyperlinks will actually be able to navigate. If I'd thrown all of the web links on the page, it would have been unreadable. But that is available. If you want to go find most of these tools, they are listed on the Social 7 Fire Wiki, which you can get to from the Fire specification page. So a couple of different tools that let you author implementation guide resources. One tool, which is currently in beta, lets you author capability statements. It defines what systems can do. If you're familiar with IHE specifications, you'll often see these described as actors. So every single system will have a capability statement that says, this system knows how to produce these messages or consume these messages, can do search or create or update them as particular types of resources, knows how to produce this type of document, etc. So capability statements are a complicated part of your IGs. Structure definitions, we use those for all sorts of different things. Profiles, extension definitions, logical models. And that's where we have our thesis set of tools because we've been doing it for a long time. So we started out with HL7 using Excel to recover that by now, but have not yet got to the point where we're super comfortable with all the other tools that are out there. And it turns out that Excel is actually a fairly nice authoring environment for some of this stuff, so we continue to maintain it. We don't promise to maintain it forever, but we do have other tooling coming on stream in terms of Forge and Trifolia and Clinfire that provide perhaps a nicer user interface and certainly more logic on top of that offering process. So those are available for use. In terms of value sets, we didn't have a heck of a lot, but there's more coming on stream now. So Fire Toolkit, which Greg Reeve has written, Clinfire, which David Payne has written, and Snapper, which is a tool that came out of Australia, and just recently got opened up to the rest of us, and it's great stuff as well. Same stuff in the code system space. Concept map, we now have some tools that help you to do that as well. Structure map, which is going to be pretty advanced, but there actually is a tool out there for authoring those as well, so automated conversion between V2 and Fire, or V3 and Fire, or Fire and something else. If you want to ship that as part of your implementation guide, there's authoring tools for that. And of course, you want to create examples. You want to have examples of all of your different types of instances. Here's what your document should look like. Here's what your messages should look like. Here's what your different REST instances should look like. Clinfire is a pretty nice environment for creating instance examples. There's a Notepad++ extension that has some fairly nice validation authoring in JSON or in XML. And then for the resources we don't have authoring tools for, or for the resources that you're not a fan of the other authoring tools, or you're just, I want to take something, copy it, make a few edits, or I want to do something that the tool doesn't let me do, you fall back on XML Spy or your favorite JSON editor, Notepad, whatever it is that you like to edit XML or JSON. I haven't actually met anybody who offers resources in RDF yet, but I'm sure somebody will at some point. However you prefer to write those, you can. And that's going to create the content for your communication. So, the HL7 IG Publisher. It's the publishing tool that's been around for the longest, which means 2-ish years, because we didn't get into implementation guide publishing right away. We figured we needed to have resources first. It's written in Java. It leverages a lot of the same code base that we actually used to publish the Fire specification. So when you look at the fire spec and you see those nice little hierarchical diagrams, and the new dictionary views, and all of that kind of stuff, those same libraries get used by the IG publisher. It also leverages the Java-based validator. So as part of the publication process, we will go through and check to make sure that your structured definitions are in fact valid constraints on the resources, and make sure that your valid view sets are valid, all that kind of stuff. Like much of the HF7 specification, IG Publisher is open source, so you can go in and take a look at the code, and you can grab a copy and modify it if you want, although we much prefer that you came to us and told us what you'd like and contributed that, because then everybody can benefit. It does drive off of the implementation guide resource somewhat, but it's much more driven off of the JSON configuration file. That's one of the things that's currently up for discussion. HL7 is how much should be in custom configuration files, how much should be in the implementation guide resource. There's arguments on both sides, and we're not finished the argument process yet. But be aware that there may be some changes coming there. The process of the IG publication, the IG publisher's approach, is we generate fragments for the different artifacts that you put in. So if you put in a structure definition, we will generate a little fragment that gives you a snapshot table view and gives you a differential table view and that gives you a data dictionary view. And if you give us examples, we will generate the example in XML, in the JSON, and in RDF. I think the RDF stuff is there now. We will also generate pretty printed views, so with markup that you can embed in your HTML or easily look at in videos, etc. And so each of the different artifact types will generate different fragments, and you could potentially come and define your own. So last week and a half, I defined a fragment that generates Excel views of structure definitions. There's a CSV view of structure definitions. You don't necessarily have to take advantage of all of those, because with these fragments, you then create templates using Jekyll, or templates that are Jekyll aware, that say, this is what I actually want to link to, this is where I want this fragment to appear. You can make your fragments or your templates do pretty much anything you wish. So if you want to include a link to the Excel, you can, but you don't have to. If you want to include a link to the CSV, you can, but you don't have to. If you are in an environment where everything is XML, that JSON stuff is weird, I don't understand it, and what's RDF, you can have an implementation guide that only exposes the XML artifacts and doesn't expose the rest. Or vice versa, if you're in a mobile environment and XML stuff is archaic, I don't want to be embarrassed by acknowledging that it even exists, you could go strictly JSON. Or, as we typically encourage, support all three, because somebody somewhere is probably going to want one of those representations, and we provide them to you, it's generated automatically, and all you have to do is include it as a reference in your template, and magically it's there. So don't exclude stuff that people can use when it's no work for you to make it happen. But I have had customers who said, nope, it's XML only, and we can do that. Once you have those templates, and the IG publisher produces the fragments, we then kick off an external static web page building process called Jekyll, which runs in Ruby. And it then takes the templates and takes the content and iterates through and says, okay, here's a page, here's a page, here's a page, and you get the pages for each of your structure definitions, for each of your examples. You take all of your static web pages and propagate those across, filling in variables like what version of Fireman am I pointing to. It also has the ability to point to the underlying release of Fireman. So that when you click on a data type, it jumps you to the definition of that data type in the release of Fire and the definition on top of it. And also knows that if you, in your implementation guide text, say, If you're interested in how this works, you'll see the specification page on references, and you can embed a tag in your HTML markup that says whatever link is spec here, references, it will check to make sure that those links are actually valid against the version of the specification that you're talking to. So it's relatively smart. Obviously, it will also go through and validate all of your instances, so make sure that your profiles are valid, make sure that your examples are valid against the base spec and against the profiles that you declare, and then it packages everything up so that you can download zip files, you can download IGPacks, etc. If you want to find the IG publisher, go to the HL7 specification. Within the specification, you'll find a downloads link. Go to the downloads page, scroll down on the downloads page, and you will find something that says IG Publisher. And if you click on the IG Publishing tool, it will download the jar. And you should also take a look at the IG Publishing documentation, because without that, you have no hope of making it run. The IG Publisher is the most sophisticated of the publishing tools that we have. You can do all sorts of very cool things with it, but you do need to set up your templates, etc. And that definitely requires reading documentation, which will take you to a few pages and things like that. Lots of people really don't want to create a whole bunch of templates. They would just like to have something that works. Thank you very much. You've got a couple of different options. One is HL7's implementation guides. Things like US Core, Structured Data Capture, etc. are all maintained either in HL7's Subversion environment or in HL7's GitHub environment. Go grab them, steal them, copy them, edit them, change them to what you want, and publish, and lo and behold, it'll work. We've also created an IG framework, which is sort of a complete implementation guide package. This is subject to continued evolution because we haven't really agreed on what an ideal implementation guide should look like. Some of us really like XHTML because I can hit F8 and XML spy and validate it. Other people hate XHTML and much prefer Markdown, so we're talking about how we want to make that work. And also about what a good implementation guide should look like. But that is a place to get started. In terms of what implementation guides can actually look like, isn't as bright as it might ideally be. Are we able to close those? Because that's kind of part of people's eyes. I know I've been sitting a little bit earlier. The faint screen is bad. The faint screen when you're sharing it is unbelievable. Want to see some of the implementation guides that HL7 has published using these tools? If you go to the main page, down at the bottom left, there's implementation guides published by HL7 affiliates in the Fire Foundation. And if you go there, and it works, you can go take a look at something like Structured Data Capture. I'll show you all the different versions of it that exist. Take a look at the current version, and this is the generated static web page that's produced for structured data capture using the IG publisher. So this is contents, section numbers, we've got an artifact index that lists all of our conformance statements, so our different actors, the different profiles, the extensions, etc. I think we'll take a look at one of these profiles. And you can see it's got a tabbed view, similar to what we would see in the actual specification. We've got a text summary, we've got a differential view, we've got a snapshot view, or a view that shows everything. All of this comes from a set of profiles. So if I go into, is that legible at all? My resolution. You don't want to make your resolution separate. I don't know that I can actually change the size of the text. In Windows Explorer?
Honest. Well, when I just.
Okay. I have learned something. All right. So if I pop over to where the structure name of capture lives. So this is my source folder for structured data capture. I've got some pages. This text here is exactly the same thing. Let me see in the home page. That's exactly that same content. So what my home page looks like is maintained as a simple XHTML fragment. And I've got a bunch of different pages, some talking about security. Some of these are notes pages that will actually show up in some of the different resources. As well, I've got the actual resources themselves, so I've got my capability statements for the different actors. I've got code systems, and in this case, I've maintained my profiles using spreadsheets. I could have maintained my profiles as XML instances maintained in Forge or exported from Trifolia. I've also got my example instances. I've got a simple includes page that says this is what I want my main menu to look like. And all of that is content that varies from page to page. I also have a framework folder, which I maintain more or less the same across numerous IGs that I publish. But this is where those templates appear. So I have a template in here for profiles, for the main page of a profile, that says I'm going to have any introductory text for that profile. Go grab it. Then I want to have a tab where I've got my definitions and my mappings and my examples. And if we go look at back to the page where we're at, that's what these tabs across here are. So all of that is defined in this template, and there's actually some scripting that is embedded that's used by Jekyll, where I can set a simple flag that says, yes, I want X, no, or no, I won't, no, I don't, and that cascades through all of those different components. So that's sort of what the Jekyll process looks like. I don't know if SDC builds right now, so I'm not going to try running that one, but I will run another one, genomics one, kick that off. One of the nice things with the IG Publisher is that you can run it as either a publish once mode, but you can also run it in a continuous mode, which means that it runs through the publication process, but it then monitors your source files, and every time you change a source file, it reruns Jekyll and pushes the changes across. So you can actually see updates in your local side of the website after 2 or 3 seconds from saving the file. So what's happening here is I'm running some local transforms. I'm an XSLT kind of person. Then we kick off the IG Publisher. It goes and grabs the IG path for the version that we're based on, which in this case is STU3. Connects to the terminology server, goes and grabs and reads all of the different profiles that I have. It's yelling at me because in spreadsheets I have declared a version, but I have a version parameter set that says change all my versions to test. Just playing around, and it's telling me to change that. And I should actually change the source. I'm lazy, so I don't. It generates narratives for all my resources, validates the resources are correct. Generating outputs is the process where it's producing each of those little fragments. That takes a little while because it's now generating spreadsheets, and generating this out takes longer than it wanted to. Then it's going to generate the web reviews, generate the summaries, is generating things like the table of contents and stuff that points to everything. Then kick off Jekyll, and that's not a process that we actually control. It's sort of standalone sort of the code. So that moves fairly quickly. Then we go and see what is all of the stuff that we've spit out into the publication folder. So grab all of those HTML files, found over 500 of them, loads all of those into memory, then goes through and checks every single hyperlink and makes sure that it resolves. And when it's done, it's going to spit out a QA file that tells me if I happen to have hyperlinks that are broken or anything else. So I've got 57 broken links. None of them have invalid HTML, and I've got some other errors in my profiles, etc. And I could go and take a look at that, and the whole process ran in just over 2 minutes. And if I was running continuously, making just a change to an individual file, it would probably take only a couple of seconds. So that's what the IG Publisher looks like and how it works. Jumping over. Another tool I want to show to you quickly is Trifolia. Trifolia is a web-based location environment. When you go there, it tells you a little bit about what it can do, but you can't really do anything until you log in. It took me a long time to figure out that I needed to log in before I could do anything useful. If you don't want your content living in some web repository maintained by a company that you don't necessarily know in a country that you don't necessarily want your stuff to live in, you can download the code and run it locally, but it does mean hosting your own web server and knowing a bunch of other stuff. So it's a little bit more work, but it's certainly possible. Once you're logged in, you can go browse and take a look at what implementation guides have been exposed publicly, and poke around at those, but of course we're not here to do that. We're here to go and create our own. I started that earlier, so we've got a dev days demo. So we'll go into that and say I want to edit it. And you give it content in your implementation guide. Give it a quick overview of part of the download. You can also go in and say, I want to create templates. So this is where you can go and create your profiles. So I want to go and add a profile, say, to be attached to my Dev Days demo. I've already inserted the Dev Days demo is based on CD3. So let's go and create a profile observation. Have to give it a name. Wants that to be full URL. I want to say the code already is 1-to-1, subject 1-to-1. Yeah, I know. I talked too much. So one of the things that you'll notice with Trifolia is that it works much the same as the CDA implementation that you produce in Trifolia, where every single constraint is assigned its own ID. Everything is a should, shall, may line, and things get represented that way. That's a style of implementation guide that's appealing to some and useful in certain environments, not as useful in others, but that's another way of doing implementation guides.
So the third tool is the IG editor of Simplifier, and I will put the demo and create an implementation guide. First you will need to be logged in, and the IG editor is part of the paid plans of Simplifier, but we can allow you to test it out. We've made an exercise which can be found on the Dev Days site. And there you can see how you can test it for yourself. So once you're logged in, you'll go to your portal. Implementation guides are part of projects. So I made a project for this occasion. And I already put in some profiles and other content, which you can also use for during this exercise. And then you go to the guides tab, and there you can hit the green button to create your implementation guide and give it a name. So Dev Days G example, my name behind it. I'll make it invisible for everyone because it's just a test implementation guide. So now you see it's created. And once you hit the enter edit button, you will go into the IG editor. And you will see that the layout of the IG editor is based in three areas. On the left side, you have the structure your implementation guide. In the middle, you have the actual editor. On the right side, you have your preview section. So I will call this about the IG. I will structure my IG very quickly. Another one. This will be the use cases, which for now we'll have two use cases. First. And there's another one. last one, specimen. So now you see I've already briefly structured my presentation guide. Now it would be nice to get some content in it. So if you go to diagnostic order, you're able to implement all resources that are available on Simplifier by giving a little statement, say render, and here you will get your project name slash the ID of the resource. So now I will look at the resources. So let's say I want to include my diagnostic report in it. It's rendering. I'll just copy the ID of it, put it over here, and hit Control Enter to see a previewed section. And now this profile is included in my implementation guide. I'll do this very quickly for all the others. Besides just rendering the rendering functions, you've got different kinds. Different kinds are available. So on the left, you have a help section which explains you what is possible, which is actually an implementation guide itself. So you will see your implementation guide in the implementation guide. If you click on it, you will see all the possibilities you can do with the idea here. So you can list it in a, you can render your profile in a table form, or enter the dictionary by, again, every time the same mechanism. So in the beginning, you have your keyword followed by the ID of the resource on Simplifier that you want to include. And this doesn't have to be within your own project, so you can include everything. Well, you've got the preview option, which will show you the implementation guide we just created. And here you will see that tree table rendering, which we created, but we also have another format which is adjustable here at the settings. We can also give a description. And now we say we want the two-level menu. And we're doing that. We have a different format, and you will see again here the rendering. To make your implementation guide a little bit beautiful, we also have CSS, which you can your own CSS, which you can add, which will make you able to give it your own look and feel. You can save your implementation guide, which will export it to an implementation guide, to an implementation guide resource in your project. This will also enable you to edit your implementation guide from within the GitHub setting. If you connect your GitHub repository to the Simplifier, to the project, you can edit the pages in GitHub, which will be synced automatically to Simplifier, and then your implementation guide will automatically be adjusted. One last final thing is we just released the Profiling Academy, which is actually an implementation guide on it, like which is made with the implementation guide editor. So here we adjusted the CSS and made the Profiling Academy. And if I'm correct, we also included, so this is done by exactly the same way as I just showed you. So the Profile Academy is a very good way of seeing what's capable of the implementation guide editor. I think I'm running out of time. So we have prepared a little exercise which can be found on the this website, which has it's also findable online, which directs you to the three different tools which you can try out by yourself, and I are here the remaining day to answer questions. So this is for the tools demonstration.